Without further ado, I'll set some of the rules. First, I'd like to introduce our two candidates tonight. We do have Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders with us tonight. To my immediate left is representing the former Secretary of State, is the former Secretary of State for Connecticut, Susan Bysiewicz. And also joining us from the Hamden Democratic Committee tonight, representing the Senator from Vermont, Bernie Sanders, is Josh Elliott. Josh. Some housekeeping rules. We plan to wrap up roughly at 8:20. I don't mean roughly as in we'll be in a brawl mode, but roughly as in that's the time frame we expect to get us all out of here at a reasonable time this evening. As has been the custom in other debates in Hamden, for example, which the Land Trust has done before, and Kurt Johnson and others have been involved in the town of Hamden, we're going to roughly use that format tonight, which has been very successful, and that would include two-minute opening remarks from our candidates. We've had a coin flip, which was won by Bernie Sanders, Josh Elliott. He elected to kick off tonight, so Secretary of State Susan Bysiewicz, our former secretary, will have the first opening remarks, and then we'll do the reverse for our closing remarks, which will also be 2 minutes in duration. For questions, I will ask the first three questions this evening. All question formats, the first candidate who will receive the question will be Josh Elliott. He'll have 90 seconds to answer. Susan Bysiewicz will have 60 seconds to rebut, and then if he so chooses, or if the other candidate chooses, 30 seconds to rebut the rebuttal. I do not have a stopwatch, so bear with us. I will hold up a hand if I think that we've run significantly longer than 90, 60, or 30 seconds. So we will start, if you would like. And I have the first question addressed first to Bernie Sanders. Yes, you do. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. I've already blown my first assignment here. I was giving the opening remarks on my own behalf. So we'll start with our two-minute opening remarks, please. First, for Bernie Sanders, Josh Elliott.
Hi, everyone. So for the progressives, for some on the left, this election represents the culmination of the last 30 years of tax policy. And there are more issues that we deal with, like civil issues, like abortion, like gun issues, like civil rights, and racial relations and racial justice. But when it comes down to it, there are strong economic entities that are flooding our system with money. And what has happened is that for 40 years, between the 40s and 70s, we had a very progressive tax structure. And that meant that the top tax bracket was paying anywhere from 90% for a couple decades to 70% for about a decade. And now we're at a point where the top tax bracket is paying 35%, or in some cases paying less than 15%, which means that capital holders are paying significantly less than those of the income earners. What this means is that they are either hoarding this money and taking it out of the system, they are stashing it overseas and making sure that it never gets taxed, or they are flooding our political system with money to make sure that more laws are enacted that help them and not everyone else. And the fact is that as the decades continue from the 1980s, it gets worse and worse. So for me and my generation, we see some big structural problems with the way the system is working. Now, we recognize that it is important to have strong governorship, and we recognize it's important to have strong leadership, and we recognize that Hillary Clinton represents that. But for us, this is about platform. For us, this is about making sure that we have a structure that works for everybody, and right now it doesn't. And the question is, how long can we live in this structure where the political system keeps on getting flooded and the business interests keep on getting adhered to? And we believe, and Bernie Sanders believes, that not much longer can we do this, because at some point, instead of 400 families having 99% of the wealth in this country, it's going to be 10 or 5 or 1. And the whole reason we have a democracy is to get rid of the idea of all the power in a few hands. So that is why we believe very strongly that Bernie Sanders' platforms are what we need to change this country.
so much. It is a pleasure to be here. And let me just say how proud I am to be a Democrat and how proud I am of both Senator Sanders and Secretary Clinton and the way they have conducted this primary campaign. They have been out there very passionately talking about what they want to do to make our country even better than it is. And they have done this in a very respectful and civil way, especially when you compare it to the debate that the other side has had, which has been extremely divisive, fraught with personal attacks and a lack of substantive policy discussion. So with that, I want to give you my top three reasons for why I am very strongly supporting Hillary Clinton for the presidency. She wants to fight for families in our country, and she has spent many months visiting with families in living rooms across the country and talking about what keeps them up at night. And what is so impressive to me about her is that she has found, for instance, that many families are struggling with relatives with Alzheimer's and has heard about the toll that that has taken on them and has learned about their struggles. She has talked to many families that have a child with autism. She has talked to families who have loved ones that are struggling with narcotics and opioid addiction. And she has taken all those conversations to heart and come up with some very specific policies to address those problems that so many families across our country are facing. And I also support Hillary Clinton because she wants to break down the barriers that prevent individuals from achieving their full potential. And that could be poverty, it could be discrimination, it could be lack of equal pay for equal work. And these are issues that make a huge difference for our country. I also support Hillary Clinton for president because I think she is best poised to continue the progressive agenda that has been started by President Obama. She wants to continue to improve and expand the Affordable Health Care Act, and she wants to continue to improve the economy and to continue to grow jobs in our country. We know the president inherited an economy that the Republicans had driven into a ditch, and we're coming out of it, but we've got farther to go. And I believe she's the best person to help us improve our economy.
Thank you. Okay. Can I just interrupt for a second? If you have cards with questions, could you hold them up over your head, and we will be collecting them, starting to collect them now. So if you have those cards, just put your hand up. One of us will grab them, and we'll start.
As legible as possible. You can. Thank you. Thank you, candidates, for your opening remarks. I have three questions before we start receiving your questions, which will come here, and I will read them and we'll conduct the rules. So the first question goes, because of the coin flip, to Josh Elliott, representing Bernie Sanders. You'll have 90 seconds. Secretary Bysiewicz, representing Hillary Clinton, will have 60, and just review the rules again. If you choose, 30 seconds to rebut the rebuttal. So for 90 seconds, here we go. First question tonight is really about the tone. Many Americans are very angry in not only the Democratic ranks, but in the Republican ranks. On the other side, the Republican candidates have tapped a nerve, you would agree, that seems to be an angry one. And the tone of the campaign has been vituperative, it's been hostile, it's been very aggressive. Would you both give your opinions as to why the GOP debates have been so rancorous to this point?
I would say that there's anger on both sides, and it is the way that anger comes out that is different. I think the Democrats do a good job of trying to funnel that anger and understand it and try to do something productive with it. Change the system, make sure it's fair for people. I think what has happened with the right is what often happens when you have those who are lower socioeconomically, and not necessarily just them, but also there are strong business interests that kind of co-align. And what ends up happening is that this anger gets funneled in ways that are destructive, in ways that single out minorities, in ways that single out immigrants, in ways that single out people who have it less well off. And it is usually nonsensical. I would actually go ahead and say that it is actually always nonsensical, but it's hard when you are just an average American to see how the multimillionaires and multibillionaires are living, and you don't see on a day-to-day how they are the ones that affect how our system works. So what ends up happening is you see the person down the street who lives on welfare, or you see the person down the street who has had three children and is living off the state, and you then equate them as the problem while you are living on $7.25 an hour, working 60 hours a week, not saving up, on the brink of not even starvation, but bankruptcy. So I think the anger comes from there, and I understand it. And the problem is that Democrats don't do a great job of reaching out to those people and explaining what the problem actually is.
You know, it's remarkable to me that the Republicans have made it their business to appeal to the lowest common denominator. I strongly believe that our country is great because of the people who came here from somewhere else. I think Hillary Clinton appreciates the value that immigrants have brought to this country, and that's why she is very strongly for immigration reform that would take the 13 million people who are here illegally and take them out of the shadows and take the people who are being productive, who are contributing, who are paying taxes, who are living as law-abiding people, and make them citizens so they can continue to contribute to the greatness of our country. And I think that we need leaders who will not divide, leaders who will collaborate and bring us together, and that is the difference between the Democrats and the Republicans in this election.
And just to add, I think what is happening with this election is a culmination of what we saw in the 2000s when Roe and the Bushes strove to take that evangelical vote, but more specifically, that sort of southern racist, we don't want people who don't look like us or act like us to be part of this country. And they used hushed tones and disguised language that is now no longer hushed nor disguised. So they have really created this themselves. So it is no surprise that now we are seeing them using very specific words that show how they are trying to manipulate the system.
Thank you. I'm going to refer to the candidates instead of Josh and Susan. At this point, I'm going to say Secretary Clinton and Senator Sanders. So they've earned their stripes. So congratulations, you're both running now. I have two more questions. Specifically, last December 2nd, this nation saw and witnessed a terror attack in California, which was homegrown. And since that time, there has been a great discussion about the role of law enforcement, federal bureau investigations, and even our other efforts overseas to learn more about terrorist channels and stopping or keeping Americans safe in the wake of that, there have been candidates calling for an outright ban on all those of Muslim faith in the United States, ranging from that back from that as well. Secretary Clinton, if you'll have 90 seconds to tell us, how would you keep Americans safe and not to have to worry about ISIS or a domestic attack?
Well, I would say this, that first, it's very important to shut down ISIS recruitment in the United States and online, because the perpetrators of the attacks in San Bernardino came from other countries, but they were homegrown. That's where they were radicalized, right here. We also need to fight ISIS by stopping terrorist training abroad. And we need to work really hard with our intelligence agencies to stop plots before they are carried out here in the United States. And I would say that while sadly we've had some attacks, we've had our CIA uncover plots before they were carried out here. And we need to continue that intelligence. And we need to empower our Muslim Americans to help us prevent people from being radicalized in our country. And the answer is not to simply prevent Muslims from coming into our country.
A lot of the problem that we're seeing is a Fourth Amendment issue, and that is, how far do we want the government to go to protect us? And we've had a rash of shootings, and we have ISIS, and we have these terrible problems with enemies both outside and inside. And the question is, how involved do you want the government to be in terms of looking at the way we communicate? And this is not an issue that will ever go away, ever, no matter what. And we may always have enemies, but the best thing we can do is be looking toward the future. And what's happened with neoliberalism and neoconservatism is that we have been going into other countries and we've been toppling dictators, and we've been trying to force our democracy down other countries' throats. And while our democracy is great, it won't necessarily work for everybody. But what we're doing is we're sowing seeds for decades down the future of enemies, of pockets of people who really hate what we represent and what we're doing. And even though we do these things that are well-intentioned, what's happening is we create these vacuums for groups like ISIS to open up and open shop and bring people in whose families have been killed, who know people have been killed. And this is a problem of things we've done in the past, and now we're trying to deal with it now. And we can by making sure that we have a strong infrastructure, but at the same time, we need to make sure that we're not doing damage to ourselves down the line.
In many of the countries where you have radicalization, they are countries where women do not have the rights that we enjoy in the United States. So if we want to make countries in the Middle East more stable, what we need to do is to make sure that girls are educated, that women have the right to vote and own property and contribute in the economy, because in countries where all those things happen, you have a much greater political and economic stability and much less terrorism. So rights for women are key to the stability of the Middle East.
This next question will start with Senator Sanders. After we discussed what had happened in California, we'll dial it back to our own tragedy here in Connecticut, December a few years ago, and 26 people, many of them elementary school students, lost their lives here in Newtown to gun violence. And specifically, after that, I'd like to know, what have you learned as a candidate and as a senator, and the same to Secretary Clinton, and how did that impact you, and how would that motivate you to form some type of
comprehensive gun safety in this country.
So, as a senator from Vermont, I recognize the difference between a hunter and a, on the one side, and a gangbanger on the other side. And of course, there is a huge spectrum. And if you lump everybody in to just one pocket that isn't looking at the issue realistically. Now, on the one hand, you could say we want all guns gone. And that is not my position as Senator Sanders. My position is that there are 99.99% of gun users who use guns responsibly. The question is, how do you keep those guns out of the hands of people who will misuse them? And sometimes it is posited that you need stronger mental health checks. And that would be, if you have a strong universal healthcare system, you could make sure that people who have health issues don't get guns. But ultimately, it comes down to making sure that there are ways that it is not easy to get guns. So there is a gun show loophole that needs to be closed. We need to make sure that assault weapons aren't easily available. We need to make sure that there is not a militarization of our police force so that we don't see guns as being normalized. There are certain cultures out there, such as the hunter culture, that can use guns in ways that are not damaging. But the problem is that we are so reactive, and when we see a tragedy like Newtown, and it truly is a tragedy, again, like with ISIS, there are certain realities that we just are going to be nearly impossible to deal with. So the answer is going to be making it as difficult as possible to obtain a gun.
I think it's important to do a number of things and to carry on the work that President Obama has done in this area, but I think it's key to limit the sale of assault weapons and automatic weapons, to make sure that there are instant background checks and that we eliminate the loophole that allows people to buy assault weapons and other very dangerous weapons at gun shows. We, of course, should do much more to support mental health. But I think that it's also important to look at what has worked in other countries. And in Ireland, for example, after a terrible shooting where dozens of kindergartners were shot to death by a gunman, there was just a ban on guns in Ireland. And after that, there was a huge decrease in gun violence. And here in the United States, we have 90 people harmed every day from gun violence. So we've got a lot of work to do.
I would echo everything that Secretary Clinton said. Alternatively, there are a lot of people who use guns in ways that are not damaging. And if you pit yourself against them and try to take down a whole industry by saying that gun manufacturers can be sued if their guns are misused in, let's say, a mass killing, you're essentially killing an industry. Now, the question is, and this is debatable, but do you want a population of 330 million people who have no guns and a military that has basically the strongest military or the strongest arsenal in the world? And that is a potential fear.
No guns. Okay. No guns.
Yeah. Thank you. We now turn to your questions, of which there are many, and if you, I don't know, Kurt, want to ask or encourage more, I think we have room for them tonight.
If you would like cards, raise your hand. Yeah. If you have cards. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, first the question, this goes to Secretary Clinton. What are you doing, what are you bringing to Connecticut in terms of jobs?
Well, let me say that as a presidential candidate, there are a number of things that I'm talking about that I hope will help Connecticut. First and foremost, I have a plan to replace our aging infrastructure, so our aging train system. And our crumbling roads and bridges need to be fixed. And in Connecticut, a lot of those things have not been upgraded since the 1950s. And that would help bring jobs to Connecticut. Also, I think it's very important to ensure that young people have opportunities, because unfortunately, young people are leaving Connecticut. More than half the young people who go to school outside Connecticut don't come back. A lot of states have that problem. And I have a plan to put $20 billion into youth job training. And I also have a plan to make sure that the 600,000 people that are coming out of incarceration every year have job opportunities to go to. And I understand that in Connecticut, there are many people who are in the correction system who need good job opportunities. And my plan addresses that.
So I have a plan, a five-year plan, to invest $1 trillion in infrastructure. This is roads, this is bridges. Secretary Clinton has a $250 billion plan to invest in infrastructure. Even $1 trillion, as determined by various groups, is not even remotely enough. And this is across the U.S. In terms of Connecticut specifically, states have a tendency to race toward the bottom, and that is give tax deductions to huge conglomerates, bring them in, and then basically almost never receive the tax benefit of having that conglomerate there. You bring jobs, which is good, and that vitalizes communities, but then you see what happens when a company like GE decides to up and move, and they basically turn an entire town into a wasteland. And we need to get away from this idea that we need to attract these huge, huge conglomerates to prop up a base, that we can do that with entrepreneurship, and we can invest in people creating new businesses, because that is the way that you revitalize a community, because people invest in their own people, in their neighbors. And there's a big difference when money is being shipped overseas, and then you would never actually see a dime of that money. So we need to make sure that we're protecting our people.
You know, I think there is a role for the federal government to play to ensure that states are not competing against one another for the GEs. Now, Massachusetts is giving GE huge tax breaks, just as Connecticut did. And who knows how long GE will be there before some other state comes along to lure them or another Fortune 500 company out. So I think the federal government should focus on a way to keep states from competing against one another for those companies.
And this question goes to Senator Sanders. In Flint, Michigan, they have had bad polluted water from bad pipes. Many of our sewage pipes are broken and leaking sewage into Long Island Sound. What role would your administration take in fixing these leaking sewer pipes here in Connecticut? And you will have 90 seconds to answer.
The answer is twofold. The answer is back to infrastructure, is making sure that we're funneling money
to make sure that our infrastructure is kept up to date. In the 1940s, we were just dumping money into making sure that our infrastructure was strong, and all the money that we put into infrastructure comes back to us. It's an investment, and it's an investment in our future, unlike tax deductions, which do not help us in the future at all. We want to be investing in education and infrastructure and our youth. The second is we need to make sure that there is a strong check on our government. And the problem is that Governor Snyder, in an effort to save the government money, opted to have a different means of having water come into the city. And what that did was made sure that there was tons of iron in that water. And we have had this philosophy in the U.S. that the dollar is the most important way of measurement, of measuring our humanity. And we see this time and time again, where in schools we are feeding our children just like the cheapest of possible food because we don't want to pay for it. But then what happens is our children have ADD and they can't concentrate, and all of a sudden our education suffers. And it's just a matter of making sure that we are spending the time to tax correctly, to make sure that we're helping each other. And what we are seeing in Michigan is just an indication that we are caring more about dollars than our own humanity. In terms of what laws that we can actually enact to change that, there might not be much other than a shift of consciousness that I, as the senator from Vermont, will help to put into play.
I think it is the most basic responsibility of the federal government to make sure that the water that we drink in this country is safe and pure. And so to the extent that the federal government has to ensure that states have available clean water for their residents to drink, I think that's absolutely key. And if it takes federal investment in the infrastructure of states to do that, I can't think of a more important role for the federal government to play. But the issue of clean water in Michigan highlights environmental justice. We have to make sure that communities, whether the poor communities, have a clean environment, just as wealthier ones do. And so with that, I will conclude.
Yeah, I agree with that. And it does come down to the issue of, in the wealthy suburbs, they are paying more money. And in the more impoverished places in Michigan, they're paying less. And the idea is that the people who are paying more in Michigan don't want their money to be funneled into the places that are giving not as much to the tax base as those who have more money. And this just comes down to this general idea of that if you are the one who earned it, you should be able to keep all of it, forgetting how you have this infrastructure to teach our children who become the workers, and you have this infrastructure of policemen, firefighters, and we need to make sure that we're doing a better job of taking some of that money and equalizing it out so that things that are basic, like water, is equal across the board, no matter how much you paid into the system.
And I would just say that particularly with fracking being much more commonplace across our country, I think it's even more important that we be vigilant so that our water supplies are protected, because in some communities where fracking has been going on over the past several years, they are now discovering that there are chemicals in the water supply that are detrimental to the health of people.
I'm not sure we'll be able to get to all of your questions. We're going to do our best here tonight. We have several, and there are a variety. I'll try to condense some of them that are on the same theme as well, so permit me that indulgence, if you will. Secretary Clinton, are you in favor of allowing victims of gun crimes, such as Sandy Hook, the ability to sue the gun manufacturers and sellers? You have 90 seconds.
Yes, absolutely, and perhaps this is where Senator Sanders and I differ. For instance, he and I have different votes on the Brady Bill. I have supported the Brady Bill at every opportunity, and he has voted against the Brady Bill five times. I have supported measures to allow people to sue the manufacturers of guns for liability. So, for example, the parents of the victims of Sandy Hook are now trying to sue some of the gun manufacturers for the role that was played in those devastating shootings. And you know, this is a real policy difference, but I think it's an important difference. And I do support manufacturers bearing the liability.
If someone kills somebody else with a hammer, does the hammer company get sued? If somebody gets murdered with a plank of wood, does the lumber distributor get sued? Yes, guns are dangerous, but if you allow a system where gun manufacturers get sued, you will essentially be putting them out of business. Now, if that is what you are intending to do, then yes, you can do that. But if you allow a system to take place like that, you're essentially killing an industry. Now, if the question is whether that industry should exist in the first place, completely different issue. That's what I would say about that.
I would just say that the defense industry in Connecticut seems to be thriving.
Thank you. And this question goes to Senator Sanders. And how are you planning to preserve Social Security?
So when Social Security was enacted, the idea is over the course of your lifetime, you and your employer will be paying into the fund. And it was a way to ensure that by the time you had reached retirement age, that you had the funds available to you and the government would support you. But really, the government was supporting you with your own money. What has happened is that there is a cap on Social Security at $118,000. So if you make over $118,000, you don't have to pay into Social Security. The idea now is that now the boomers have reached the age of retirement, there aren't enough of the millennials to pay into the system to keep Social Security solvent. So we need a new system. That system is going to require the people who have it off the best, the millionaires and billionaires, to pay in a little bit more. And that is, if we don't do that, we could go back to a time like the 1940s when half of our senior citizens were living in poverty. And what we had happen was after we instituted Social Security, we are now in a time when only 10% are living in poverty. But it's going to get worse unless we fix it, unless we demand as a people that there is a better system. And it's okay for those billionaires and millionaires with that extra dollar to be putting that away, and 70 cents of that dollar, or however much, in terms of Bernie's plan, it's 52 cents, and that's the marginal tax bracket of 10 million and up, to be putting a little more into the system for our elderly. And that is fair. That is definitely fair.
I agree. I think it's very important that we do what is necessary to support Social Security and make it solvent for the long term so that everyone can rely on it. And I definitely oppose the Republican initiatives to try to privatize it or weaken it.
Okay, moving on to our next question tonight. Do you, Secretary Clinton, have a comprehensive plan for the Middle East? You answer first.
Yes, I do. And I would say that I bring my experience as Secretary of State, where I had the opportunity to visit 112 countries, more countries than previous secretaries had visited, because I thought it was very important to visit countries, particularly those that are dealing with the threat of terrorism and the countries that are breeding grounds for terrorists. Also, as First Lady, I had the opportunity to interact with world leaders, particularly in the Middle East, and I believe I have the best experience to make our country safe and to keep Americans who are living abroad safe. I don't think it would be easy, but I do think one of the key parts of my plan to make the Middle East safe is to support women and to ensure that women have the right to vote, that women have equal educational opportunities, the opportunity to serve in government, and the opportunity to be part of the economy, because in countries where that happens, you have much greater stability.
For some reason, there is this consensus that simplicity in foreign policy is a problem. And that simplicity is non-interventionism. You could argue in the last 100 years of U.S. existence that we've had one war that was worth fighting, and every other war that we've been involved with was just not worth fighting. It wasn't worth our tax dollars, and it wasn't worth our American lives. When you have someone like Hitler, and they have an allies who want to take over the world and change the way people live, that is something that you need to be proactive about. When you have a dictator in a country that is killing its people, that's not good. And you want to do something, but that thing is not to ride in like the white knight. That thing is to make sure that you have a global consensus, or as much of a consensus as you can get, so that you have allies that are in the area, so that you're not flying your people in, you're not boating your people in, and your people aren't dying for a cause that may not end up being helpful when you open up pockets for other problematic entities to enter. So every time we do something, there's always a reaction to every action. And when you do something like topple a dictator, you're going to have groups like ISIS. The best thing you can do is make friends.
And I would agree that it is important for the United States to have allies in whatever we do. We've learned that lesson in the global war on terror, and I think it's an important one.
This next question is for Senator Sanders, and I'll read this as presented. How do you, as a candidate, view campaign finance reform and getting big money out of politics?
I love big money in politics. So there's a problem, and that problem is that for the last 30 years, business interests have found a way to infiltrate the system. This isn't a conspiracy. This is just people acting rationally of their own accord, wanting the world to look the way they want it to look. And what has happened is that they've been able to hedge their bets and shovel money into Republicans' pockets and Democrats' pockets and keep us arguing about all these civil issues while forgetting that there are bigger issues like the 2008 crash, where after that was done, we took all of our money from our middle class and shoveled it into the pockets of the ultra wealthy, enacted no new laws, sent nobody to jail, and all of a sudden we're sitting here with banks that are bigger than ever, and Glass-Steagall just totally crippled, and Dodd-Frank barely doing its job. And it's not going to get better until we change that system. The fact is, we came close in Connecticut, but we weren't able to pass it because all of a sudden we're dealing with the budget deficit of this year. And next year it'll be the budget deficit of that year. And the year after it'll be the budget deficit of that year. And when are we going to make it a priority to fix the fundamental structure of our system? So 2010 came along and Citizens United was passed. And that basically said that money is speech And if you are limiting the amount of money that goes into campaigns, you are limiting free speech, and that is a load. That is a total load. But what has happened is over 30 years, we have five members of the Supreme Court who are pro-business. And that is a big deal. So what we need is to make sure that whether Hillary or I get elected, that we get someone who is just not as pro-business. It's okay to have good business philosophy and structure, because you want to be able to support your people and support your economy. But you want to make sure that those aren't the only interests adhered to. And as we go along and have no fixes, this is a problem that gets worse and worse. And as you, when you have a problem that gets worse and worse, there is a certain point where there is no return. And this is what we see when major civilizations fail, and that is when the power is in the hands of the few.
So how can it be that we have the Citizens United case, which says that corporations are people? Something is wrong with that decision, and it needs to be overturned. We must overturn Citizens United. We have to stop super PACs and end secret money in politics, where you can have very wealthy individuals give unlimited amounts of money to support candidates, to oppose candidates, to do all kinds of nefarious things. So I support greater transparency in ending super PACs. And also I support a system very much like the one we have in Connecticut, which is that you have a small donor matching program to get special interests and big money out of politics and make people and ideas more important. That's what's key to reform our campaign finance system.
There's a fundamental difference between the way that Secretary Clinton and I are funding our campaigns. To date, I have raised more money from more contributors than any presidential candidate in the course of history. My opponent is raising money from banks, from big pharma, from the healthcare industry, and from Wall Street. And if you want to know which one of us is going to represent who, all you need to do is look at who gets you elected, and that is a fact. You look back to FDR, you look back to Teddy, and they realize that you can't be friends with everybody. There are going to be some certain losers and winners. And what Hillary is saying is that everybody can be a winner, but everybody can't be a winner, because when Big Pharma is winning, the people who have to pay for those drugs are losing. So if you want to make sure that money gets out of the system, don't vote for the person who is taking the money that is influencing the system.
If candidates, Senator Sanders would allow a rebuttal, you will have one. Okay.
So I would say this, that I have over 2 million contributors, and 94% of my contributors gave less than $80.
94% of
your money. We're gonna allow this to go back and forth.
Alternatively, 70% of what Hillary has raised has come from max donations. Super PACs that have raised $15 million from the banks. And they said, we are not going to spend that money on the primary. We're going to wait till the general. And what they do about 3 weeks ago, started spending money in the primary. Because the big money interest wants to win. And in super PACs, there are no limits to how much money they can put in. When they give money to your campaign, it's maxed out at $2,700. That is the last sliver of protection that we have against big money. But they can put $100 million went into Bush's campaign before he started, before he even announced, flouting basically every single regulation that's out there. So yes, there are a lot of small donors that are giving money to Hillary. At the same time, there's significantly more money that's coming from big donors that we have no idea how to trace them back, because it's dark money.
All
I just wanted to ask, so when you say that banks are giving money to Hillary Clinton, what exactly do you mean by that? Because companies cannot contribute, it's only individuals.
So these are people who are the CEOs or capital owners of these big companies, and what they're doing is they're able to take this capital that they've gotten from their industry and shovel that money into these campaigns. So it is not the actual banks themselves, but it is the people who represent the banks.
So inherent in your answer is the assumption that somehow Secretary Clinton is soft on Wall Street. So why don't we talk about that? Because when Senator Clinton was the senator from New York in 2008, she went to the big banks and said, hey guys, and you'll forgive the gender reference, but hey guys, you are engaging in highly risky behavior, and if we don't do something, we're going to have an economic collapse. And so she is on record saying that. She is on record trying to hold banks and Wall Street accountable. She wants to stop the high-frequency trading, which is a huge problem. She wants to close the loophole that allows the hedge fund people to pay 15% of their income in taxes while regular working people are paying a much higher rate. So I would argue that she's been very tough on Wall Street. She would like to fix Dodd-Frank, make sure that the Consumer Finance Regulatory Board is stronger because it's constantly under attack, like Dodd-Frank, from the Republicans. So let's talk about Wall Street if that's what we're really getting at.
I would say words are air, but actions are concrete. And if you look at Secretary Clinton's 4 years as senator, that no new laws were enacted. And it's fair and well and good to say that she went out and told these big banks to stop it. The problem is, if you are the person who can create these laws, you don't ask, you tell. You say, if you don't stop, I create this law that the people who got me elected want me to do to preserve our economy, and that just never happened. And it's fair and well to say that she wants to do it, yet I don't understand why people in that industry would put money into her campaign if she is going to regulate them. There is one place that the money is not going to, and that's Bernie Sanders' campaign, and that is because he wants to regulate the industry in earnest, and he's been saying the same thing for 30 years, and he's not going to stop now, and that's why we believe in his platform.
By the way, we're game for breaking format again anytime you both see fit. We don't have to stay within the confines. This isn't CBS, NBC, ABC, fill in any blank. And since we are talking about media, and I sort of segued into that, I have a question for both of you. First to Secretary Clinton. Do you feel that the media or mainstream news has given accurate and fair coverage of your campaign? Why and why not?
Wow. I would say that at the beginning, I was not impressed with the fairness of the coverage. But I will say this: I compare it to my last campaign in 2008, where there was a news magazine that had 30 different pictures of what I was wearing, and not the same for the male candidates. So fortunately, in this campaign, I have not noticed that. And I think that's a good thing, because I think fair coverage is important. I don't know, Senator Sanders, what do you think?
I agree with that fully. I think they're... that the mainstream media looks at women differently than it looks at men, and it looks at women in a way that is very superficial. There is a higher bar to entry that is systemic and unfair. I completely agree with that. Alternatively, in terms of my campaign, there has been essentially a media blackout for a full year. And even when we were doing significantly better than Trump, there were months and months that went by that he was getting 80 to 90 to 100 times the coverage that I was getting. Now, if you talk about media bias, that seems fairly biased. Jeff Bezos, who is the CEO of Amazon and is worth $49.6 billion, bought Washington Post last year. In the last 24 hours, there have been 18 articles that have come out that are regarding the presidential campaign. Two about Hillary that were fluff pieces, and 16 about Hillary that were all hit pieces. Now, if you ask what is going on in the mainstream media, again, just look to the money. That is all you have to do. The fact is that super PACs have to pay about 10 times the amount that any other normal campaign would have to pay. So what is happening is these large conglomerates are getting enormous influxes of money from the way that our campaign structure is laid out. So yes, there is a problem, and yes, there is a problem in the way that both sides are being represented.
You spoke for one moment. Bernie had 16 hit pieces right against him in the past 24 hours.
You said Hillary.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, it was Bernie who had 16 hit pieces against him. Thank you.
To Senator Sanders' point about Donald Trump, how is it that Donald Trump was he was like a walking political reality TV show? And how was it that he generated all of this media interest in every tweet, every nasty remark he made that somehow attacked certain groups of people? I'm aghast he has any support, because it seems to me he's offended just about every group that possibly exists. So that is the remarkable thing about the media and their fascination with Donald Trump, and I think the senator and I agree on that point.
Thank you. And now this next question goes to Senator Sanders, and it's a two-form question, and I'll read it as such. Why doesn't Secretary Clinton support $15 minimum wage? Why does Senator Sanders support a $15 minimum wage?
The big fear is that if you institute a $15 minimum wage, that hits entrepreneurs and small business harder than it hits massive companies, because they have profits that can withstand the blow until the economy normalizes. However, we are saying that we want a $15 minimum wage because wages have stagnated to the point where college education is 10 times more expensive than it was 30 years ago, yet, and that's adjusted for inflation, yet the minimum wage is about half of what it was worth 30 years ago. So we are going to structure the increase in minimum wage over time. It's not going to take place right away. It's going to take place over a span of, let's say, 5 to 10 years. It's nothing that's laid out specifically. So the fear is that it will put different businesses out of business. But the reality is it's going to be structured in a way that companies and businesses can slowly withstand that blow. And what will happen is that the money will then get recycled back into the system. So yes, workers will get $15 an hour, but they'll be spending that money, so capital owners will still be doing just fine. But instead of the money just flowing to the capital owners, it'll be flowing through the workers back to the owners. So that's it. That's my answer.
So I know that Secretary Clinton strongly supports raising the minimum wage. She supports equal pay. She supports paid family medical leave. She supports universal pre-K. This is the first time I've heard that she doesn't support raising the minimum wage to $12. Okay. Well, I'll have to talk to her about that, because I like 15 better. So I'm going to use my 2 minutes with her to see if I can convince her.
Okay, I think there is a resolution here on the stage. Perfect. Made it very easy. Thank you. This next question is starting with Senator Clinton. Secretary Clinton, who was a senator as well. So,
made it easier if we had the same honorific tonight. What is your plan for resolving the heroin epidemic?
So I have gone around the country and had the opportunity to talk to families who have lost loved ones, who have, I think, helped put this issue on the radar of the national campaigns, and I think it's important. And in here in Connecticut, last year we lost over 400 people of all ages to heroin addiction, and so we need a program to prevent people from getting addicted. We need to make sure that law enforcement officers, as well as family members of those that are addicted, have access to Narcan so that overdoses, lethal overdoses, can be prevented.
It's not simple, but it's simple enough. First, you have to recognize that addiction is a disease, and then you need to make sure that people have access to healthcare. And the way that you do that is by making sure that you have universal healthcare. If we had a way to make sure that we could funnel people, or not funnel people, but allow people to use our healthcare system in a way that's beneficial, and we don't treat people who have addiction as problems, as criminals, and we say, listen, it's going to be free for you to go to a doctor to see how to get help. But right now, if you have an addiction and you don't have health insurance, how do you get help if you have that addiction? You can't. It just is not available to you. So that's the answer. It requires changing our mind on what addiction is, and changing our mind, or changing our relationship to drugs, and then making sure that we are protecting the people who need protecting.
Thank you. This next question goes to Senator Sanders. It's actually, I believe, for you, and I'm going to, pardon me while I put on my cheats. It only gets worse as time goes on, doesn't it? I'm struggling with some of the writing here, folks. Typically, countries that lean towards socialist ideology have an income tax rate upwards of 50%. How can the ideology be, in quotes, sold to U.S. voters? 90 seconds.
By making sure that everybody has equal access to information. If everybody knew how bad the income disparity is in our culture, worse than it's been ever in the history of the US, if people knew that 8 to 12% of the world's wealth is stored in offshore accounts, if people knew how easy it is comparatively to live on an income of $5 million, $2 million, $1 million compared to $18,000 or $20,000. If people understood the difference in the quality of life, then there would be a mass insurrection against our system. And the fact is that people just don't know because they don't see it. And you have to be informed, and then it is your job, once you are informed, to inform. You need to make sure that people know that there is a really big problem with the way our system is laid out, and that it's, if you have the top X percent, it can be 1%, it can be 0.1%, but if you have the top percentage of people taking outsized proportion of what the economy has to give, and that is growing year by year, then it's a no-brainer that we can make people who get that much to pay back into the system. It's a total no-brainer. But people need to know that it's possible that all of a sudden the CEOs and capital owners are all going to throw up their hands and go to some utopia where it's just them and nobody else. They need the middle class. They need workers. The labor creates the capital. And if you don't have that, then you don't have a system that works.
Desperately need to fix our tax system, and one of the biggest loopholes is allowing hedge funds that create millions of dollars in wealth for their executives. We need to close that carried interest loophole. So right now, hedge fund managers get taxed on the gains that they make in their funds at 15%. So that's the capital gains rate. That should be taxed as income at a much higher rate, 30+%. That's just basic fairness, and we need to get our Congress to do that. And I have had great success in reaching across the aisle to do that, and I will make that my priority as president. The other thing I would say is I support the Warren Buffett rule, which is very simple. If you make over $5 million a year, you pay a third of your income in taxes.
The top nominal tax bracket has become a ruse. It's become a ruse because the ultra wealthy have their money in capital. They make their money with capital, not income. That means they own companies, they have shares of companies, they have equity, and what they do is they kick it back from year to year. So what that means is that, let's say you have $1 million in company X, and by year two, company X is worth $1.5 million. You don't pay tax on that $500,000 that your wealth has increased, unlike everybody else when you make money. You actually kick that back year after year after year. And we just don't know a better system of doing it. We can't be evaluating businesses and equities every single year. So what we have to do is make sure that that tax bracket that they're paying is more than 15%. So the 50% socialist kind of like boogeyman is really kind of just, it's not accurate. It's just not accurate. The fact is that the ultra wealthy are paying like 12 or 11 or 10% when people making $30,000 or $40,000 are paying like 20 or 25 or 30%.
Thank you. We have a few more questions before we have our opening, or I should say our closing statements. Unless you want to do this again, we'll have an opening statement. We'll rerun everything in the tape that we have tonight. Thank you. This is actually addressed from one of you to Secretary Clinton, and I'll read it as presented. Currently, there is an FBI investigation of your emails and certain dealings of the Clinton Foundation, namely taking money from foreign sources in return for favors. Even if it's unlikely to happen, if there is an indictment during the general election, would it guarantee a President Trump or Cruz?
So here's what I would say. With the emails, I have been completely transparent. I have turned them over for the public to see. And second, I would point out that there is some deeply partisan stuff going on because Condoleezza Rice and Colin Powell did exactly the same thing that I did, and they were not criticized at all. So I've done everything that it has been required of me. I do believe that this is a partisan attack. And, you know, I know Senator Sanders is tired of hearing about my damn emails, but I would just say, hey, if I have to turn over all my emails, well, all of my rivals should turn over all of their emails.
Pardon me while I go to the second part of the question, which is, even if it's unlikely to happen, if there is an indictment during the general election, could it guarantee a President Trump or Cruz?
In terms of emails, I would say that it was an error in judgment, that Secretary Clinton had a team of people to advise her, and yet somehow nobody thought of, maybe it's not a good idea to have one of the most powerful people in the United States to have an unsecured server. And if you have somebody who is in IT, who's working on your team, that is just, it's a no-brainer. You have to encrypt it, because it's not a matter of what you send out, it's a matter of what you get back. And yes, maybe it's the case that Secretary Clinton sent nothing that was of national security that could be a breach. On the other hand, it's the fact that it could have been, and that is an error in judgment. And it shows, perhaps, that you think that you are above the law. And that's a very dangerous position to take if you are leading people, because that is the same position that dictators take. I'm not saying that Hillary Clinton is in the same realm as a dictator, but what I'm saying is it is a slippery slope between what you can and can't get away with. So the moderator mentioned Hillary Clinton taking money for her foundation. Now, here's what's happening. The Clintons are going out and talking to different corporations, conglomerates. In response to that, these conglomerates are putting money into the foundation, so the Clintons don't have to actually represent on their taxes that they have gotten this money. There is quid pro quo, but they are getting around that by saying, no, 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 it's just a donation to our foundation. What the foundation then does is pay for their clothing, pay for their food, pay for them to fly around the country, so it's a way for them to skirt the laws of taxes. And the question is, do you want somebody who is in the power of, has the leadership power to be flouting laws that literally all of us have to adhere to?
I would simply say that the foundation run by my husband has done some great things, like providing clean water, AIDS treatment in other countries, and we have been very transparent about that.
This next question is addressed to Senator Sanders, and I'll read as presented. Do you believe the rhetoric you use in regards to the upper class is creating an unnecessary divide of the classes?
Creating? Created? It's already there. It exists. There is that struggle. And frankly, there will always be that struggle, and that's okay. What we have done with capitalism is that we've taken human greed and we've used it in a way that is productive. We've used it in a way that you can say, okay, I want to make more money, I'm going to create this thing. And that is a great system. But if you have unchecked capitalism, you have the power in the hands of the few. So to say that recognizing that is creating the divide is a disingenuous way of putting it, because the fact is that divide is there. There will always be a divide between the ultra-wealthy and the poor. The question is, how bad do you want it to get? How ultra-wealthy should the ultra-wealthy be? And the fact is, we have a democracy, and we can all decide what those metrics should be. And to say that we can't decide that, it flouts the whole purpose of living in a democracy. We're in a democracy because we say, listen, it's great that you made this much money. It's great that you created this company. And it's great that you're creating jobs. But you need to be fair. There is no other check but democracy to make sure that people who are taking too much don't take way too much. And we're already there. And we're just remarking on it. And that is not creating it. We are just showing the mirror up to the people. Listen, this is what's happening. We either fix it now or maybe it just doesn't get fixed. And if it doesn't get fixed, we have way bigger problems than, you know, well, maybe not. Maybe Trump is the biggest problem. So let's not go there.
We have a couple more questions, three more questions before we have our final closing statement tonight. This is a question for Secretary Clinton. Secretary Clinton says she's for responsible fracking, but most experts say that fracking is seriously harmful to the environment. It's also true a few days ago, Secretary had a fundraiser that included members of the fracking industry. Can we trust you on the issue?
I think I'm gonna have to look into that one.
30, 60 seconds, you wanna respond?
At the town hall last night between myself and Secretary Clinton, the secretary was asked, do you support fracking? And after about 30 seconds of hemming and hawing and saying, maybe it's a state issue, maybe the governor should decide, she eventually said, yes, I do. And I said, no, I don't. And that's all you need to know. The fact is, we need energy in this country, but We also need to have a long-term energy plan. And the fact is that fracking does not fit into a long-term energy plan. And all we're doing is bankrupting ourselves in the short term so that we may never get to the long term. Because all fracking does is pollute our water systems. And if there's one thing we need to make sure that's clean, that's our water system. We learned that from Flint. We learned that from day one that we're born. The water is the most important asset that we have. It keeps us alive. We can do without energy. We can't do without water. So when it comes to fracking, if the technology is not there, you can't learn by trying. You just don't do it until you know that it's effective and you know that it's safe. And it may be effective, but it sure as hell is not safe.
Okay, this final question, we'll start with Senator Sanders. And essentially, I'm going to paraphrase this if I might, but I think I know the intent of your question, if you'll give me the opportunity. The GOP has a hold on Congress at this point, and relations with President Obama have been fractious, not fracking, but fractious, over the last 7.5 years. How would you propose to work across the aisle with the Republicans?
You don't. You don't. You can't. You can't because of the system, because money's in both sides. It's set up in a way that the less that happens and the less laws that are created to fix problems, the better it is for the people who have it good. So the fact is that yes, we have Bernie Sanders who is spearheading this movement, but this movement is not Bernie Sanders, and this movement is not about Bernie Sanders. He's the person who's there as our leader now, but the fact is there are a lot of people out there who recognize that with the way the legislature is made up, there is no way that we can get anything passed. And just as we have the worst income inequality that we've had in our history, we have also seen less laws enacted than we've ever seen. Stagnation is status quo. And the only way that we're going to fix that is if we make sure that we come out in numbers and change the way that our legislature looks to make sure that they're looking out for everybody and not just the few.
So, two things about working with the Republicans. I've had the opportunity to reach across the aisle and to work with Republicans. I'll just give you one example. After 9/11, when I was senator in New York, I asked for aid to help rebuild after the Trade Center bombings. And there were Republicans in the United States Senate and in Congress that did not support that idea. And I worked with President Bush to make trillions of dollars in funding to help New York rebuild. And I'm proud of that. Having said that, I have also watched the Republicans in Congress try to thwart President Obama every step of the way, and it was fortunate that we were able to pass the Affordable Health Care Act, which has given 20 million new people health insurance that didn't have it before. And the Affordable Health Care Act is not perfect, but there's a lot more work to be done. And as I run for president in this cycle, I'm going to make it my mission to get more Democrats elected to the United States Senate and to the United States Congress to work with them. And I'm going to make it my mission to appoint a justice to the United States Supreme Court who will help overturn Citizens United.
That concludes our questions from all of you. Thank you for your submissions. Some good questions tonight. This is the portion where we have our closing statement and agreed to by our coin tip we had earlier. Senator Sanders, you have the first 2 minutes to close.
From the beginning of this election cycle, there has been a certain portrait painted of my opponent and a certain portrait painted of me. The portrait that has been painted of my opponent is that she is fearless, she is a strong leader, She is a strong voice for women. She is competent, and she knows the workings of the government. And those are all strengths. There is no doubt that those are all strengths. The problem is that Secretary Clinton wants to be the good guy for everybody. And the fact is, as FDR said, he welcomed the hatred of banks. He welcomed the hatred of certain industry. And you have to. You have to. You can't be the friend to everybody. Sometimes you need to make enemies to make sure that the system works. The fact is that I, as Bernie Sanders, have had a platform since day one. And day one started 30 years ago as the mayor of Burlington. And then I became a congressman. And then I became a senator. And I've been elected into office 12 times. So if you're talking about electability, my opponent has gotten elected once. I have gotten elected twice. In the state where people know me best, I won by a landslide. I won every single pledged delegate. If you want to know who's going to be trustworthy, who's going to look out for what the American people need, and not even just the middle class, but people who have it the absolute worst off, and making sure that if you want a meritocracy, you need to make sure that education works for everybody, that everybody's fed, that everybody has healthcare. And the fact is, I've been fighting for the same thing for the last 30 years, and I go from state to state, and my message does not change depending on who I talk to. My message stays the same. It will stay the same when I get into office, and it'll stay the same in 4 years when I win re-election, and it'll stay the same after I'm done and doing humanitarian work. The fact is, we need to make sure that people are protected, and you need to know that the person you are going to be electing is going to do what they say. And the fact is, I will be doing what I say, because I've been saying the same thing for 30 years, and the people who know me best trust me. And that is what I need to get across to everybody out there, is that I am the one who wins in a landslide when it comes to trust issues. And sure, you can have a leader who is fearless and who is experienced and who is polished, but the question is, can you trust that person?
Well, so much for coming, for being so enthusiastic and participatory, and I hope it bodes well for our primary and our general election. I appreciate your passion, and I can't wait to fight for America's families, to fight for equal pay, to fight for affordable college for everyone, to fight to make sure that our criminal justice system is reformed, to break down the barriers that exist in our country that keep our children from achieving their God-given potential. And I look at the other side of the aisle and I see that they are not about diversity. They are not about breaking down barriers. They're about building walls and making other people pay for it. So we have a lot of work to do to bring our country together, to rebuild our economy, and to continue to make our country great. And I thank you for helping in that process, and I appreciate your energy and enthusiasm, and I hope that you will join me in getting as many people as possible to vote and participate so that we can make a difference together. Thank you.
That concludes our formal portion of the debate. Thanks to Josh Elliott and Susan Bysiewicz.